The Lord be with you. A reading of the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to the Lord.
Jesus made his way to towns and villages, preaching and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom of God. With him went 12, as well as certain women, who had been cured of evil spirits and ailments. Mary surnamed Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had gone out. Joanna, the wife of Herod's steward, Chusa, Susanna, and several others who provided for them out of their own resources. The Gospel of the Lord. So we come to a close of the Corinthian Paul's writing to the Corinthians. And it has really been an exciting journey to deal with and to reflect more deeply with St. Paul and the Holy Spirit, this letter to the Corinthians, and to be able to see and to place ourselves in Paul's time and to transport that context into our time. And that's what reading the Word of God is about, entering into the life of the experiences and allowing those to influence us. And so Paul here is dealing with a big problem. People are saying, the heart of the business, so Paul yesterday from Corinthians 3:11, Paul outlined the kernel of the faith, the kerygma. Today Paul is dealing with the issue at hand. So he laid the foundation as to what is the belief of the church that he had received, of the faith that he had received, and now what he is doing, he is in fact dealing with the issue at hand. And what is the issue at hand? People are saying that there is no resurrection from the dead. So this is the real issue that Paul wants to treat with. And I think this is where Paul has climaxed to in all that he has been doing, because this is the central issue of the faith. And he says, if Christ has not been raised from the dead, is what we have to preach, how can some of you be saying there's no resurrection from the dead? So we recognize that some of you are saying that there's no resurrection from the dead. And Paul begins his explanation, the proclamation of this, the unraveling and the unveiling of this mystery at the heart and center of Christ. If those who have died, if there's no resurrection from the dead, first and foremost, then Christ has not been raised from the dead. Because Christ being raised from the dead is not a singular event, but it's an event that prefigures all who are united to Christ. So he says, if there is no resurrection from the dead, then Christ has not been raised from the dead. So Paul turns the argument up on the inverse. And therefore, he says, and if you have not been raised from the dead, then all those who have died have perished. And more so, if Christ has not been raised from the dead, you will not be raised from the dead, it means that you are still in your sins. So Paul has just collapsed the entire Christian faith on this singular doctrine of the resurrection from the dead. That's as how important this is. And that's why Paul climaxes here. That's how important it is. If Christ is not, if we will not be raised from the dead, then Christ has not been raised from the dead. If Christ has not been raised from the dead, then we are still in our sins. And if we are still in our sins, those who have died in Christ have all perished. And therefore, we are the most unfortunate of people because we are proclaiming a lie. And so Paul brings clarity to that fact. But then he says, but we know that Christ indeed was raised from the dead, and therefore we too will be raised at the last day. And so the whole sense of last things is important for us to understand where Paul is coming from. Corinthian community was a gifted community, was a highly spiritual community. And what they were doing, in fact, was spiritualizing the resurrection. They were spiritualizing the resurrection to say, well, when we come into an encounter with Christ, then we receive everything. Once we give our lives to the Lord, we receive everything here and now. And so there is in that immediacy in which we are transformed, and that transformation that we have experienced and received, we there's nothing more than that transformation. So they spiritualize the whole experience. And yes, they are right, but only partially so. The encounter with Christ and our faith professing Christ immediately transforms us into new creators. And then Paul himself would say, I'm a new creation in Christ. The moment we have confessed our sins and been baptized in Christ, we are a new creation. And Paul would know this, as he proclaimed in Romans, the letter of the Romans. But we have to keep the tension. On one hand, we already have received everything, the new life. But on the other hand, it's not yet consummated. So we have received the fullness of Christ, but on the other hand, it's not yet fully consummated. And so what Paul had to caution some of them about is that if you are not careful, you can very well lose your salvation. Huh? Philippians chapter 2 verse 12. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling. So Paul on one hand saw the fulfillment of salvation at what we call the last day, and the eschaton, when Christ comes in glory. And until then, even though we have the first fruits, Paul in Romans chapter 8 tells us a down payment, a guarantee of salvation in the Holy Spirit. We have a down payment. That down payment of salvation that we have received, that's what it is. The fulfillment of which will be on the last day. If you go by courts or standards and you pay down on something, you put a down payment on it. Until you pay off it, it does not fully belong to you. Because if you stop paying for it, they'll come and take it back. They'll come and take it back. And so Paul is saying that we have a down payment of salvation in Christ by virtue of our baptism and God giving us His Spirit. But if we don't live our lives accordingly to the gospel of Christ, then we can lose it. And that's why he's addressing this same thought. That's why some of you are with your stepdaughters. And Paul deals with that issue at the beginning, saying, what I'm hearing in this community, I've never heard anywhere else. That some of you are with your children's, your wife, mother, and all this kind of crazy thing. And Paul is saying, if this is the case, then you're not understanding fully who Christ is. And people are able to do that. If I believe, well, I haven't paid. I'm already saved. And there's nothing I can do for me to lose my salvation. Because I'm already saved. And so their lives that they were living were not in keeping with the gospel value. And this is all linked now to the resurrection, in that they were saying there was nothing more that we can have because we had everything already. So whatever we do, when we live, there's nothing we would lose. Paul is saying, no, that's not true. You have a moral obligation to live your life according to a particular way, lest you lose your salvation. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Already we have it. God has given us a down payment. But the fulfillment of that down payment will come when we see God face to face on the last day, when the Lord raises us up and raises us up in glory to give us bodies like His own. And so Paul proclaims a resurrection of the body, the flesh. It's important, very important Christian understanding of resurrection. It's not just spiritual, that on the last day, that our bodies will once again be raised up from the dead. just like Jesus' body. That's why the disciples were able to touch and see the wounds in Jesus' wounds, because it was the same body. It was the same body that Jesus had, that God had raised up at the resurrection. It was the same body. And that's why it's important for us to recognize the resurrection of the body. It's not just a spiritual thing. It's not that just I'm going to survive death and go on for all eternity as a spirit. I'm going to survive death and go on to eternity as a spirit. But on the last day, on the day when the trumpet shall sound, the Paul says, the dead in Christ shall all rise, then we too shall experience the resurrection of the body. And that is the doctrine of the church, which we profess in the creed, which we profess every Sunday, that we believe in the resurrection of the body. And therefore, we must ever be mindful of this central teaching in our faith. In the Gospel today, we see Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Chusa, the wife of Herod's steward, and a whole bunch of women taking care of Jesus, trying to fatten Jesus. You know, like they set up the priest trying to fatten him and bringing all kinds of things to eat. But these women were doing the same. They were trying to fatten Jesus. They took responsibility and had a ministry to Jesus. And they too were Jesus' disciples. So Luke here balances the masculine and the feminine, the male and the female. Here Luke talks about the 12 disciples, but he also talks about the women who followed Jesus. These women followed Jesus, as we saw yesterday, because of the love that they had for him, because of what he had done for them. Taking away, exorcising 7 demons from from Mary Magdalene, and for the healings that he would have done for them. And out of their own gratitude, they in fact had a ministry towards him, that they would follow him and make sure that he had all that was needed for the ministry that he was doing. And of course, he and the disciples. So that was their ministry. That was the way they showed their gratitude and they showed their love. That's the way in which they took care of Jesus and made sure that all was well with him. Very often people get a distorted concept. So historians could write back and one reinterpret the relationship that Jesus had with Mary Magdalene and put all kinds of untrue things in there. And because very often we understand the kindness, spiritual heart, and love by which people can operate from and out of. And so, this ministry that these women had, I'm sure every priest can attest that there are probably some women who try to give them a punch, a belly, but all of the among the food that they bring. But more than that, it was a care and concern that they offered Jesus. We saw an example when Jesus would go to Mary and Martha, and how they would treat him, and how he found rest and repose there, how they ministered to him, how he was able to go there, he had a room there whenever he passed through, and he was able to rest and relax, and minister, and they took care of him and they listened to him. That was a deep friendship. We saw the deep friendship when their brother Lazarus had passed away, because Jesus had that deep friendship with the entire family. And that's why they were so distraught. And that's why Jesus himself was so distraught when Lazarus passed away. The text tells us that Jesus wept. And so it is out of that relationship and friendship and love that these women, and gratitude, that these women attended to the needs of Jesus, because they were his friends, they were close to him, and they ensured that he had all that was needed for the ministry that he in fact did. Mary Magdalene has gotten caught up again in all kinds of things that she's not of, or was not of. that Mary Magdalene was a prostitute, that Mary Magdalene. The woman who came with the alabaster jar yesterday was not Mary Magdalene. That was another thing. This Mary Magdalene is a woman who Jesus cast out seven demons from. But very often, again, as we said, we so like to castigate and denigrate and see in bad light that we project on the text things that the text never said or things that were never present in the text. And therefore, we begin to read in a very negative and bad light everything, but that was never in the text, and we will not find it in the Bible, unfortunately. And so it's important for us to take on board exactly what the Word of God is telling us this morning. And so we thank God for St. Paul and for the letter he wrote to the Corinthians, the first letter to the Corinthians, rich in teaching, pastorally and spiritually and theologically. We thank God for all the women who continue to minister out of the goodness of their hearts to the many priests and ministers that they may be friends with. We ask God's blessing upon them this morning.